Hello, everybody, and first of all, Happy New Year to you all. We are resuming our activities today, and this is already the ninth session of our PWL International Seminar, a seminar which, as you know, is hosted by IFILNOVA in the context of the FCT-funded project Mapping Philosophy as a Way of Life. It is a great, great pleasure for me to shortly introduce you to our speaker today, Professor Laura Mueller. Laura Mueller is an assistant professor of philosophy at West Texas A&M University. Her research interests include philosophy of education, philosophy of culture, and philosophy as a way of life. Professor Mueller's research focuses on the relationship between pedagogy and personhood, and education, community, and cultural values. In this context, she explores various theories and practices that embrace education as a fundamentally transformative process as part of PWL. And besides that, she also focuses on ways in which institutions, such as neoliberal universities, are obstacles to ethical development and PWL. I believe this is the topic of our talk today. She has contributed to collections such as Philosophy of Culture as Theory, Method, and Way of Life, published by Brill in 2022. The Cultural Power of Personal Objects, Traditional Accounts and New Perspectives, published by Sunny in 2021, and The Person at the Crossroads, A Philosophical Approach, published in 2020. As part of her research in PWL, she is a certified logic-based therapy and consultation practitioner through the Logic-Based Therapy and Consultation Institute. She is also an editor of VEDAS, a journal for philosophy of culture, and fellow of the American Institute for Philosophical and Cultural Thought. The title of her talk today is Vicious Academics, and without further ado, I will give her the word. Thank you so much for accepting to give this talk.
Thank you so much, Marta, and thank you for everyone for coming to this. So good morning or afternoon or evening or whatever time of day or night it is for you. Before I get into the paper proper, which I will be reading in conjunction with showing some slides, I want to talk a little bit about the history of the project, because the project is in some ways a little bit odd insofar as it's more focused on professional philosophy as a way of vice, rather than the more capacious theme of philosophy as a way of life. So all of the writing in here, unless otherwise stated in quotations, is my own writing, I think, but this project is not a single authored project, and it's not meant to be, especially in its fullest form, which it is not yet in. The project emerged as an active document in early 2023, but the idea came about long before this with my dear friend and constant collaborator, who all of you know, Eli Kramer. Eli and I had long been frustrated with academia before either of us were somewhat safely ensconced in our tenure track jobs. And specifically, we were initially vexed with particular kinds of behaviors from senior scholars, behaviors that were not only expected, but often rewarded. So after a few years of this, we decided we should probably write something down since we had a really good list going. And from there, we began to create what we hope someday is a taxonomy of vices, particular to academia and its practitioners, and we began to think more seriously about the project and topic. And there are also elements of this work that stem from another collaborative project with my colleague here at WT named Ryan Brooks, and that's on Dewey Education and the Neoliberal University. I've been very intentionally for the past year or two working almost solely on collaborative projects instead of single authored work. So this is one of the, I guess, ways that my various collaborative projects are merging together. And I should note too that this is a true work in progress. As far as I know, there's no clear goal or no clear end to it. I don't know what we'll end up doing with it. And at the end of my reading, I have included some questions that we're still working through and hopefully some questions for lively discussion among everyone here. So just a short project overview. I'm going to start with some scholarly context of this paper to give credit where it's due, and I'll go over the scholarly context here in a moment. And from there, I'll move on to a thematic section on the university, discussing some commonly asserted goals of university education, as well as the history of the contemporary neoliberal university. From that point, I will focus on the golden and post-golden ages of higher ed. And then from there, I'll get into the topic of specific vices, focusing on two of them. And then, as I said, end with some conversational questions to hopefully open up some discussion. So the scholarly context section here, this paper is in the context of both PWL scholarship, obviously, and that time-honored tradition of identifying intellectual vices as a form of self and social criticism. While it's hopefully obvious to all here that PWL is undergoing quite the resurgence, there seems to be a decided lack when it comes to focusing on institutions, particularly institutional obstacles to self-transformation. There are a few notable exceptions in recent work, some unpublished, some presented, and some recently published. So for example, we have Matthew Sharp's presentation at the PWL kickoff conference this past summer in Lisbon. We have Eli Kramer and Lyndon Walk's presentation for this very seminar that was in 2023. We have Sharp's recent article called PWL for the 21st Century Academic Philosopher, and Sharp's and Turner's work on bibliopolitics. In adjacent topics, we have Luis de Miranda's edited collection on philosophical health, Kramer's and Faustino's works on post-pandemic philosophy, and many other works authored by the very people present in this Zoom room. It is no great secret that many of us are ill at ease with the current state of academia, nor is this discomfort a modern phenomenon. Complaining about academia is part of our philosophical history. From Francesco Petrarch's laments to Schopenhauer's acerbic complaints to Nietzsche's cutting witticisms about the state of professional philosophy, all in their own times. We have historical philosophers who focused on epistemic and moral vices, such as Francis Bacon's Idols of the Mind, that dolorous Italian Leon Battista Alberti, and I just want to shout out to John Sellers for a great presentation on that one, and Mary Estelle's Injunction Against Men, Marriage, and Customs That Keep Women Vain and Ignorant, to name but a few. In recent work in that regard, we have Sari Cavisto's 2014 text, Vices of Learning, and Anne C. Villa's 2018 book, Suffering Scholars, historical surveys that carry on such traditions. While there are many new and historical works on epistemic and moral vices and on problems with the professional shape of academia, however, there's not a lot of work that unites the two that looks at institutions as the very structures that shape our moral vices and that might indeed make us worse people somehow. Understanding the obstacles to self-transformation is important, especially for professional academics. We often find ourselves at the head of the classroom, teaching about virtue and morality and hoping against hope that at least one student will find themselves altered. We believe in Bildung, but often find ourselves unable to really achieve it. The particular obstacles this paper will investigate are the vices of academics, vices that are either formed by, reshaped by, or supported by the current manifestation of the educational institution, the neoliberal university. More incisively, institutionalized academia has become a breeding ground for the vicious academic, a professional academic who, whether they intend to or not, has become a creature of these academic vices. As Kramer and Faustino outright state, academia shapes us, quote, sometimes for the better and most often for the worse, end quote. The current iteration of the university, a neoliberal institution that has consumerized education, creates an environment that morally harms its faculty. Not only does this environment limit the ethical agency of the individual, but in doing so, creates agents of vice that perpetuate the harms that form them. Academic vices are a particular concern for faculty, considering both the proclaimed purposes of the university and the individual faculty members' role in fulfilling such goals. The university is as near to a secular holy place that one can find. And many university faculty might describe teaching or research or both as a calling, as if it's akin to some religious vocation. Teaching is special, and teachers are a vital force in the creation of any culture. Faculty are meant to fulfill the most important goals of education, whatever these goals are, and they range from building to reflection to practical skills to citizenship. A common claim regarding university education is that, quote, a central purpose of the profession of teaching college is to equip all types of students with knowledge and experience, coupled with reflection, which enables them to put their learning to use, end quote. Philosophers, of course, have their own visions of education. Whitehead, for example, asserts that teachers have a most important duty: educate students for life with a capital L. Education imparts, quote, an intimate sense for the power of ideas, for the beauty of ideas, and for the structure of ideas, together with a particular body of knowledge which has peculiar reference to the life of the being possessing it, end quote. For a pragmatist like John Dewey, on the other hand, educational institutions were supposed to teach students how to engage in a democratic mode of living. If, as Dewey says, order is simply a thing which is relative to an end, then we must teach democratically if we want democratic ends. Thus, teaching to the test and pushing memorization is no way to teach, for it instills too much individual competition within students. Progressive education, as he calls it, should be pursued in such a way to increase this democratic mode of living. Other scholars, of course, have other things to say about the importance of education, and thus the educators. Bertrand Russell asserts that educators should produce excellent individuals. Qualities of excellence include vitality, sensitiveness, courage, and intelligence. If we want a more historical overview, we can look to Kant on education. Education in general, says Kant, either provides us with or cultivates within us certain things that, quote, bring our nature one step nearer to perfection, end quote. Only through education, he says, can man become man. He is merely what education makes of him. Around the same time frame, shortly after, we have Wilhelm von Humboldt declaring that education was supposed to develop the individual. Education was vital for Bildung. Quote, it is precisely education whose object it is to develop the individual, end quote. For Anna Julia Cooper, education developed the individual and the Black race. It was transformative for Black Americans to grow beyond the mechanical existence white people forced upon them. Every soul, she wrote, had the right to its own highest development, and education was a way of developing oneself. The test of any institutional system, for Cooper, is the kind of person it develops, and this includes educational institutions. She writes, quote, you propose a new theory of education. What sort of men does it turn out? Does your system make boys and girls superficial and mechanical? End quote. Through different points in history, different social issues, different philosophical systems, different languages, and different interests, one thing remains somewhat constant. Apparently, educational institutions and their faculty matter. After all, who educates at the institution? The faculty do. Educators and their institutions somehow develop people into persons, provide social and ontological hope, and create better citizens. Higher educational institutions and their educators were supposed to, in some way or another, as Pierre Hadot writes, train people for careers as human beings. But the idea that educators and educational institutions can accomplish such an important task for humanity implies that educational institutions and their educators are fit for the job. Faculty must be pedagogically sound at least, and morally sound as well at best. This also implies that institutions in which faculty teach and research creates an environment for pedagogical and hopefully moral virtue. However, as Pierre Hadot found, the very conditions of university life did not, and still do not, promote or develop full human excellence. The idea of philosophy, Hadeau says, has been, quote, reduced to its conceptual content, end quote. We see this in university textbooks and in the structure and content of courses. Universities do not, in their current neoliberal manifestation, provide an environment for the good or virtuous life. In fact, they do not only not cultivate such virtues needed to fulfill these high hopes for education, but instead cultivate vices. The neoliberal university, as it now exists, dwells in the post-golden age of educational institutions. It was in the golden age, however, that the tenuous roots of neoliberal education spread out until they became entrenched in the firmament of higher ed. After World War II, American universities once more saw vast shift and entered this golden age, which was a period roughly from 1945 to 1975, when the American university system was rapidly expanding due to the baby boom, the strong US economy, the GI Bill, the Cold War, and other factors. This golden age of education was a time of investment. Quote, this was a time when leaders in government and academia made newly conscious of the social importance of higher education by the war, were feeling their ways toward educational policies appropriate for the conditions of a new era. In these discussions, no premise was more widely accepted than the importance of preserving fundamental diversity among institutions, end quote. A proliferation of funding, especially federal defense funding, led to a period of expansion, more schools, and higher population enrollments. During this time, universities also transformed themselves into institutions open to millions of students and actively pursued research in many disciplines. As Melinda Cooper relates, low-income students, women of all demographics, and other minority students found college accessible due to federal grants and loan systems, especially the Pell Grant and tuition-free public universities. Rather than take out student loans and take on the risk of massive debt, students could pay for college up front with the Pell name, so named in 1972 after Senator Claiborne Pell. Cooper writes that Pell grants, quote, were generous enough to cover both tuition fees and living costs, liberating students from the need to rely on contributions from their parents, end quote. Grants had the effect of welcoming unprecedented numbers of low-income Black, Latino and Latina, and women students into colleges and universities. This commitment to higher education, marked by the Higher Education Act of 1965, was the result of shifting notions of what higher ed meant for the nation. Higher education was an investment in human capital. Thomas Schultz helped promulgate this view that, quote, spending on human services such as education should be considered an investment rather than an act of consumption, and therefore that education itself should be considered a form of capital or interest-bearing asset. The government did not invest in the idea that education leads to self-cultivation or reveals some inner self through Bildung. Rather, higher ed was a necessary weapon in the Cold War struggle against the Soviet Union. The USA needed technological advancements in weapons and technology, and it needed a growing economy. Students may have been seen as citizens in training, persons to be equipped with the moral reasoning and critical thinking necessary for a functioning democracy, but they were an investment expected to yield certain returns in order to serve that democracy. Federal funding was an investment in human capital. This investment was closely tied into nationalistic visions of knowledge production. Milton Friedman and Simon Kuznets also saw students as human capital, suggesting that students could be persuaded to sell stock in themselves and then were obligated to pay a portion of their future wages as dividends to their public stockholders. Friedman, Kuznets, and Gary Becker argued in favor of private, not public, investment in education. The argument over whether higher ed was a public or a private investment came to the forefront of the conversation, but either side was firmly entrenched in the notion of human capital. Clark Kerr the Chancellor of Berkeley in 1952, and the President of the University of California in 1958, saw public investment in human capital as serving two ends, that of domestic social justice and that of national security. It was this conflation of domestic social justice and national security that Mario Savio, a leader of the free speech movement and graduate student at UC Berkeley, protested in 1964. Referring directly to Kerr's book, The Uses of the University, Savio accused Kerr of treating students and faculty as raw materials to be made into products. He stated, quote, "But we're a bunch of raw materials that don't mean to be, have any process upon us, don't mean to be made into any product, don't mean to end up being bought by some clients of the university, be they the government, be they industry, be they organized labor, be they anyone. We're human beings," end quote. And then came Ronald Reagan. After Reagan won the presidency in 1980, his education reform effectively cut federal spending on education. He associated education with social welfare, accused students of acting like unruly children who needed discipline from their parents, and managed to drastically cut student aid. Through the 1980s and 1990s, both Democrats and Republicans found common ground in the idea that students should depend first and foremost on credit rather than direct grants to fund their education. Student debt became a right for all. Education wasn't democratized, but debt was. As Melinda Cooper relates, quote, "By 1985, the number of freshmen participating in the Pell Grant program had fallen by nearly half." This cut has steadily continued. Over the last decades, states have scaled back their education funding by $9 billion. And so Reagan and human capital theory of education ushered in the post-golden age of higher ed. This age, the post-golden age, our age, is one in which we see public education defunded or privately funded, with more and more of the cost of education resting upon students via private debt. University administrators have multiplied while full-time and tenure-track faculty members decrease. From 1975 to 2009, university administrators increased by 231%. At the same time, 70% of university teaching is done by contingent faculty. They are cheaper to hire, easier to fire, and don't come with health benefits. Universities are now central expressions of market trends. Students themselves tend to understand their education as training to be part of a workforce, rather than education as a method of self-cultivation or social consciousness and development. This seems the very antithesis of the vision that Hadeau represented when he discussed education as a way to train people for careers as human beings. So this is the age of the neoliberal university, and it is the age in which our current academic vices are created, fostered, nourished, and sustained. Neoliberalism is more than just some economic system. It is a governing rationality that structures our experiences of the self, the world, and others. It is, in short, an interpretive paradigm in terms of capital. It, quote, "formulates everything everywhere in terms of capital investment and appreciation, including especially humans themselves," end quote. As Foucault states, neoliberalism extends the economic models of investment cost profit to, quote, "a form of relationship of the individual to himself, time, those around him, the group, and the family," end quote. Neoliberalism in particular focuses on human capital, which emerges from an extension of economics into non-economic domains. Income becomes relevant over and above wage, for income is the product or return on a capital. Humans choose to invest their capital to receive some return or income, whether that income is monetary, psychic, or something else. Capital, then, is not an income or a wage. It is what makes future income possible, and what makes future income possible is the worker herself. Thus, the worker, the person is now the homo economicus. As Foucault says, the worker is, quote, an entrepreneur of himself, who is being for himself his own capital, being for himself his own producer, being for himself the source of his earnings, end quote. Academic pursuits of knowledge have become academic capitalism, which, quote, refers to the variety of ways in which markets, states, and higher education are increasingly interrelated and the implications of the blurring of the lines between these spheres, end quote. It is focused on profitability in terms of knowledge, knowledge production, and research. By productivity, academic capitalism looks for labor that directly leads to profits. Quote, the downside, of course, is that such a transformation is likely to lead to an erosion of the capacity of academic institutions to generate positive knowledge, let alone critical thought, end quote. The knowledge universities disseminate is sought primarily for return on investment, not for developing the capacities of citizens, sustaining culture, knowing the world, or envisioning and crafting different ways of life in common. If the university should be a place for people to become persons, for students to become fully human, to achieve Bildung, or become good citizens, or a plethora of other goals philosophers have tasked educational institutions with, then, as I have said, it's the faculty who are somehow supposed to be fundamental to this process. There is, however, no evidence that academics, especially philosophers and particularly ethicists, are any morally better than anyone else. We are philosophers and scholars, but first we are human. Or to take Hume somewhat out of context, be a philosopher, but amidst all your philosophy, be still a man. In short, while we may despair over bad institutional practices and lackluster students, we are no better at moral resistance than the rest of the lot. Eric Schwitzgebel has devoted much research to this topic. His findings are disappointing, but not surprising. Most ethicists, he found, don't even give the question of their own ethical consistency much thought. He states, quote, they'll toss out responses that strike me as flip or are easily rebutted, and then they'll have little to add when asked to clarify. They'll say that academic ethics is all about abstract problems and bizarre puzzle cases with no bearing on day-to-day life, end quote. Ethicists, he found, aim, like almost everyone else, for moral mediocrity. Behavior doesn't change, though our opinions of others and ourselves might. Interestingly enough, even though professional ethicists are inclined towards moral mediocrity, they think they're better at morality, or at least better at moral reasoning and more protected from unconscious bias. They are wrong. Schwitzgebel and Cushman performed a study in which they presented scenarios representing three moral principles to philosophers and non-philosophers. The principles were the doctrine of double effect, moral luck, and killing versus letting die. Schwitzgebel and Cushman were testing whether or not order had an effect on moral judgment. The order in which the scenarios were presented should not affect one's moral judgment if that judgment derives from stable principles. Philosophers, it turns out, showed no greater tendency than non-philosophers to use consistent application of moral principles to reduce order effects on their judgments. In fact, their analysis found that philosophical expertise actually enhanced post hoc rationalization. Perhaps one is not surprised that the everyday person might show instability in moral concepts and occasionally a weak level of moral reasoning. But do we not expect better of philosophers or other academics? It is indeed a great disappointment. As Schwitzgebel states, quote, part of what I find unnerving about the cheeseburger ethicist is that she seems so comfortable with her mediocrity, so uninterested in deploying her philosophical tools towards self-improvement. Presumably, if approached in the right way, the great traditions of moral philosophy have the potential to help us become morally better people. but in cheeseburger ethics, that potential is set aside, end quote. And for this article, he was quoting, this quote is from, a cheeseburger ethicist is the philosophy teacher who might teach something like Peter Singer on vegetarianism and personally finds the argument sound and valid, and then has a cheeseburger for lunch. So according to Schwitzgebel, there are those ethicists who could do better, but instead choose moral mediocrity. If universities are meant to be institutions that cultivate the self, that create persons, that allow humanity to unfold and promote democratic values, then the kind of university in which that occurs will affect what exactly is unfurling its being. Or if large formal institutions encourage certain types of selfhood, a rudimentary insight on of organizational sociology, then higher education today is undoubtedly producing damaged people. Universities today produce these damaged people. Academia in general comes with its own set of vices that we seem helpless to fight against. In addition, the neoliberal university emphasis on human capital, on knowledge capitalism, or instrumentalism and production, on jobs training rather than human development, has added its own flair to the vices already particular to the professional academic. So for the rest of this presentation, I will focus on two vices in particular. One is the vice of bullshit, and the other is metrics mania. The essence of bullshit, Harry Frankfurt writes, is not that it is false, but that it is phony. Bullshitters have no concern for the truth, whether that means telling the truth or lying. Bullshit is fundamentally about faking things. My contention is that while universities do not make explicit liars out of us, or at least not all of us, though academia does have its fair share of liars, it does make us into bullshitters. Philosophy in particular is supposed to be protected from both falsity and bullshit. As Kant says, only philosophy faculty have access to the truth. Faculties of theology, law, and medicine must follow the dictates of the state. Philosophy, however, concerned only with reason and truth, is free from the grasp of government. The philosophy faculty, which he refers to as the lower faculty, is above governmental interference. While the other three faculties are a mixture of reason and texts, which is an empirical source, philosophy alone is in the domain of reason in all its glory. In Kantian terminology, we might say that the philosophy faculty is supposed to be autonomous, while all other faculties are merely heteronomous. Philosophers, in other words, are free from serving the interests of governments or institutions or any outside sources because philosophers are concerned with truth, with reason, and its fruits. We can see this in Kant as an early form of academic freedom. And yet today, the philosophy faculty is in the same boat as all the rest. Quote, deans and provosts might still assert the importance of academic freedom, public education, and intellectual curiosity, but only if such qualities are subservient to predetermined technocratic targets, end quote. This is not a new concern. Hadot pointed this out himself in What is Ancient Philosophy, writing, quote, the choice of professors, course topics, and exams is always subject to objective criteria, which are political or financial, and unfortunately, all too foreign to philosophy, end quote. The malodorous piles of academic bullshit are more plentiful when we step into the fields of flattery and etiquette. University requirements of civility and the push for etiquette over ethics makes ever more narrow the possibilities for frank speech, or paresia, into academic philosophical life. Paresia, a mode of truth-telling, is a spiritual exercise, a way of caring for the self. One shares one's opinions freely with others in order to heal and cultivate the self and others. This truth-telling is, quote, a form of psychagogy that depends upon the active participation of all members of the community in the correction of one another. Frankness, then, includes both the practice of balanced criticism as undertaken by the sage and the disclosure of private sentiments for the purpose of correction, end quote. Carried out with goodwill and fraternity, it is a way to examine one's conscience and help others examine theirs, and is a remedy to the moral stagnation that occurs when one is puffed up with flattery. We see this in Plato's Lysis, in which Socrates thinks, but does not verbally advise, that Hippothiles should humble Lysis rather than praise him. We are often blind to our own moral weaknesses. Parisia, as a truth-telling, shines a light on our flaws so that we may remedy them. University policy, however, makes no room for frank speech, and in fact works to curtail its possibility, replacing the discourse of truth-telling with the codes of etiquette under the guise of civility. Professional etiquette became a code of conduct that led to civility. One is civil if one acts professionally towards others in particular ways. Civility, as accomplished by etiquette, is thus deeply rooted in the norms of academic professionalism. As the culture of professionalism grew, and as specializations became more prolific, so did special codes of ethics as ways to demarcate professional culture. Practical codes of etiquette referred to the conventional forms of intercourse by which practitioners related to each other. Often, as Burton Bledstein recounts, etiquette defeated ethics and the public's right to know and be safeguarded against incompetence. For example, an individual might be charged with unprofessional conduct and even lose his right to practice for publicly expressing differences of opinion or expressing anything that could cause the public to lose confidence in the professionals. Thus, publicly airing differences, even differences on vital public problems, was a breach of professional etiquette that often defeated the codes of ethics, which was the profession's responsibility to the public. We can see professional etiquette in academia today in the form of institutional demands for collegiality. While the three basic categories for faculty evaluation are teaching contributions, intellectual contributions, and service, there is an increasing tendency to add a fourth criterion to the mix, collegiality. Collegiality is generally used to denote enthusiasm, harmony, and agreeableness with other colleagues, as well as collaboration and cooperation. But it is ultimately a vague term used to uphold the status quo, the cultural norms, and protect those who benefit most from those norms. As an evaluative criterion, collegiality exists to uphold the professional status quo, often to the detriment of ethical behavior. The American Association of University Professors, also known as the AAUP, cautions against the use of collegiality for two reasons. One, it has historically been used to ensure homogeneity and exclusion within departments, and two, collegiality chills academic debate and inquiry. Historically, the legal use of collegiality has been to uphold institutional and individual discrimination and harassment. Employees who speak up against harassment and discrimination have been summarily dismissed for not getting along with their coworkers. Collegiality has also been used as a justification for tenure denial, despite glowing reviews and long histories of renewals. In fact, collegiality first emerged in 1981 in Mayberry versus Dees. Assistant Professor Mayberry was denied tenure despite five previous positive evaluations and renewals. Ultimately, the court determined that tenure involves more than a certain time in service and more than positive renewals and evaluations. Collegiality, the ability to relate well with other scholars at the university, became legally relevant. Mayberry was simply not collegial enough, despite his previous positive evaluations. Collegiality as a demand within academia is directly related to the stifling of academic freedom. Part of academic freedom and part of the quest for truth is dissent, disagreement, and debate. Such conflict, however, is deemed uncivil and often the grounds for dismissal. Take, for instance, the case of Paul Bally's dismissal from Ryerson University in 2019. sparing interesting but non-relevant details. This case was, in essence, a case of academic freedom versus civil discussion. Fulfilling part of professional duties, Bally wrote a letter of recommendation, or an LOR, for a student whom he refers to as Karen for PhD program admission. A certain Professor M at a United States university that Karen applied to contacted Bally, stating that his letter for Karen was unhelpful and suggesting that he withdraw it. Bally, not seeing how or why his letter could be construed as harmful, but knowing that withdrawing an LOR in the middle of application cycles would be harmful, forwarded the email to his student Karen, who asked him that he would ignore this professor's advice. A withdrawn LOR in the midst of an application cycle, as I said, is harmful, and Bally was aware of this. 11 days later, Bally's boss emailed him, requesting a meeting about this letter. Another professor from another university, known as Professor X, had bypassed Bally and emailed his boss complaining about the letter. After an exchange of emails in which Bally, one, assured his boss that the letter was appropriate, and two, asked for the exact nature of the complaints, the conversation became more fraught. Bally's supervisor would not reveal the nature of the complaint or state who the complainant was. After a month, his boss stated that Bally was defensive and not forthright. To his chair, Bally responded, quote, "You've more than enough info now to defend me from this bullshit charge. Instead, you go with the flow of bullshit," end quote. In a later email, Bally states, quote, "But given the power imbalance in our relationship, and given that the complaint poses a threat to my livelihood, not yours, I'd say that equanimity is the privileged of the empowered in this case. And those under threat are more likely to seem or become strident and uncooperative. You found it suspicious I was getting so defensive. What else should I be?" End quote. There is more to the story, which ends in Bally's non-renewal. He was docked 11 out of 15 points on his intractability score, thus giving the edge to another applicant. And here is the crux of the matter. Bally used uncollegial language that called out bullshit for what it was. He chose ethics over etiquette and was summarily punished for his deeds. He exercised parrhesia and was buried in bullshit in exchange. Here then, we can see both problems of collegiality. One, civility is the privilege of the empowered, as Bally wrote. Demands for collegiality uphold the status quo. And two, civility stifles academic freedom and inquiry. This is no way to authentically engage with one another, especially in a discipline held to the highest standards of truth-seeking. As Schopenhauer bemoaned, any philosophy that was not in harmony with ad normam conventions was dismissed from the university. Quote, "It never occurs to a professor of philosophy to examine a new system that appears to see whether it is true, but he at once tests it merely to see whether it can be brought into harmony with the doctrines of the established religion, with government plans, and with the prevailing views of the time," end quote. University philosophy was, we could say, the philosophy of the flatterer, the bullshitter, the collegial and civil faculty. Educational institutions cultivate and reward phoniness to varying degrees. Scholars are urged to tell untruths and revel in all kinds of depravity and deceit in seeking to satisfy their selfish interests and trying to secure advantages for themselves. And that's a quote from The Vices of Learning. In the age of neoliberal universities, philosophers find it necessary to deny truth in order to make room for bullshit. University philosophers, by and large, suffer from what we might call a sick soul. William James defines the most egregiously sick soul to be the one who cannot cease contemplating evil. There is, he says, something wrong in the very essence of his nature. They suffer from a profound joylessness, an unceasing depression. The academically sick soul focuses not on evil, but upon something perhaps even more all-encompassing. Allow me to paraphrase James to elucidate the point. The academically sick soul is that of the person who, quote, cannot so swiftly throw off the burden of the consciousness of work, but is academically fated to suffer from its presence. Academic philosophers, or academics in general, are, by the very nature of the job, consistently, unrelentingly consumed with work. Work, it's true, is a complicated word with a rather vague meaning. Is work only what we explicitly get paid for? Is work what we do when we don't want to do something? Is work that which takes effort? Is unproductive labor work? Is anything actually unproductive? Must all things be productive? Am I working when I'm sitting at home thinking about this presentation while I'm eating cheese? It's also unclear for unsalaried and salaried academics what we actually get paid for. Yes, we are compensated for teaching, prep, grading, office hours, class design, and activities that happen on campus. Some might say we also get paid for the writing and research we do over winter and summer breaks, which are usually non-teaching times, even if we get no summer paycheck. Work might include what we have to do in order to work. I have to publish to get tenure, and a great amount of my writing happens over the summer, which is not by default included in my yearly pay schedule. If I enjoy it, is it work? One thinks of Julian Morrow, the enigmatic classics professor in Donna Tartt's novel, The Secret History. The protagonist, his student Richard Papin, recounts parenthetically, "Work," he said to me once, astonished when I referred to our classroom activities as such. "Do you really think what we do is work? What else should I call it? I should call it the most glorious kind of play." Well, Julian Morrow was also independently wealthy and in the novel donated his salary to the college. Rather than a life to cultivate, life is now a labor unit to meet certain standards of productivity. Faculty are seen as entrepreneurs who invest in and produce knowledge. As Melinda Cooper points out, two driving reasons behind federal funding of public education were advancing weapons technology and economic growth. Faculty are producers of research, not just researchers. Kramer and Faustino frame our situation nicely in this black quote here, stating, "Future researchers are increasingly treated as entrepreneurs of themselves, who must adapt to and comply with the rules of a highly competitive market, to which the university is, perhaps above anything else, supposed to prepare them. Young PhD students are thus quickly introduced to the bibliometric surveillance system and strongly encouraged to develop the entrepreneurial competencies and skills they will need to acquire in order to achieve academic success, regardless of their chosen field of study, never mind way of life, and of course, including the humanities." Obviously, especially to our faculty members, and perhaps even more especially to the ones in the liberal arts and humanities, existing in these conditions leads to its own psychological side effects and cultivates its own vices. As stated, academics are obsessed with work, and this is because we are defined and valued in terms of our ability to produce. There is no off switch. So a quote here from Peter Fleming's text, Dark Academia. "For one thing, the normal psychic protections we once relied upon are seriously eroded when the division between self and work, life and labor, all but disappear. This is not just about addiction to email and high-tech communication devices, which is certainly ubiquitous in academia. Instead, it goes to the heart of the neoclassical vision of what labor intrinsically means. For example, human capital theory was developed by Chicago School economists to demonstrate how human existence is primarily an economic one, no matter where or when you are. This includes marriage and all other personal activities. The economy never switches off, and nor should you. Contemporary academia is a notorious case in point, given how many experience it as a vocational calling. We are what we do. We live our careers to the point of exhaustion," end quote. Faculty, like the Athenians who condemned Socrates to death, are focused on the wrong things. Journal metrics, publication numbers, conferences. Teaching has become less about transmitting the wisdom of the sages and more about customer service. Even that most sacred vocation has been profaned by student evaluations. And because it is a vocation, faculty cannot so easily pack up and quit. If one wants to be a full-time philosopher, most of us have to philosophize within the university. The great irony, of course, is that working within these very institutions disrupts in large part what philosophy is. The scarcity of jobs and constant pressure to produce something, the need to be competitive to remain relevant, leads to a metrics mania. Due to the publish or perish mindset and the competitive job market, academics are obsessed with self-promotion, metrics, and reputation. Matthew Sharp nicely sums things up, stating, quote, "With the neoliberal fostering of competition as the universal elixir for excellence and the increasing scarcity of secure positions in higher education have come cultures of rivalry and envy, exploitation and burnout, as well as steepling pressures favoring sophistical self-advertisement or even gaming the metric system to get ahead," end quote. It's safe to say that many academics are no longer only concerned with truth. They are also concerned, often by necessity, with metrics as a measure of excellence. Academics, for example, have to show the impact factor of their work. Citation indicators show academic impact, and academics have to carefully plan projects and actively influence citations of their good work. Scholars turn away from niche topics or new research, instead focusing on well-established areas, knowing that they'll have sufficient interest and thus more citations. They often choose trendy topics or safe topics for the sake of reputation or impact. And of course, there are negative consequences to this. Scholars are less inclined to undertake new research, and they, quote, may even ignore findings that do not fit the story they're trying to sell, end quote. High metrics keep institutions happy and increase their reputations. Clearly, metrics don't measure the quality of the work. They measure the attention the work gets. And those who are already well-established tend to get the most attention. This is known as the Matthew effect. Scientists who are already well-known will get more attention than new researchers. Luxury journals are also a problem. These are top-tier journals that have limited space, thus creating more competition from researchers to get published. Thorsten Gruber suggests publishing in open access journals since they do not have artificial space limitations and are not under pressure to sell subscriptions to libraries. Additionally, they are not hidden behind expensive paywalls, only accessible to the elites who have one, a private subscription, or two, access to libraries with subscriptions. Of course, those concerned more with reputation than accessible truth might not find that appealing. While publishing in open access journals is becoming slightly more normalized, the fetish for luxury journals has not yet been vanquished. And here we have a quote again from Fleming's Dark Academia. "Careers and occupations have been thoroughly tied to the fetish of top-tier journals, even among those who feel disadvantaged by the arrangement, which indicates how tough it will be to undo the precepts of academic capitalism. But one thing is patently obvious, that single-author journal articles trapped behind giant paywalls are now considered the pinnacle of scholarly excellence, indicates just how vanquished this workforce really is," end quote. Metrics mania has a mutually reinforcing relationship with the consumerization of research and knowledge. As stated before, under the ideological umbrella of neoliberalism, faculty have to sell their work. Not only is publishing in a top-tier journal often the goal, but one must also publicly advertise their work so more people read, download, retweet, and cite it. The more we sell our work, the more it is a product to be advertised, sold, and commercially valued. The more we reinforce the normalcy and acceptability of metrics mania. Furthermore, the more we are obsessed with metrics, the more we feel the need to be an entrepreneur who produces, advertises, and sells a product meant to be consumed and measured by others. So research focus is now often on increasing interest for the sake of downloads and citations, not on moving to the next project, improving the work published, or adding to our overall body of knowledge in the pursuit of truth. What then are we to do in the face of such institutional obstacles to our virtue, and we might say institutional cultivators of vice? The institution, after all, seems an undefeatable obstacle. In light of that, I offer a few solutions for what they're worth, harnessing what is within our control. One, realize, as Marc Bousquet so eloquently states in his book, How the University Works, that it's not that students and faculty are treated like shit, as he says, but rather, again, paraphrasing him, we are the shit of the university. Universities use graduate students for cheap labor, and the PH holders are the excrement of the system. In light of that, we can better harness joint faculty and graduate student power in organizations like unions. For those who are unable to join a union, like myself, who lives in Texas, where it's really hard and possibly illegal to be part of a union, we do have some control over things like faculty handbooks, departmental standards, and a great amount of control over course content to make what changes we can. Handbooks and standards are what denote which publications count, for example, or how much metrics actually matters to the tenure and promotion process, and how much weight one chooses to place on collegiality, if one chooses to consider it at all. There are, of course, more vices to taxonomize and more conceptual matters to clarify. Eli and I, for example, are slowly thinking through the next vice, the existential angst of assessments, which I am once again working on right now, and I'm sure many of you are. Furthermore, we are working again slowly on distinguishing between maladies, as Luis de Miranda writes on, and vices as discussed in this project. I also offer a few conversational questions for the remaining time. One, since this paper is written within the scope of American universities, and this is a global research group, I'm wondering, how do other universities globally differ in maintaining or warding off such vices? And two, so the university is but one example of an institutional obstacle to virtue. In what other ways do institutions or customs operate in this way? How do institutions in general stagnate the quest for philosophy as a way of life? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Laura, for such a clear and thought-provoking presentation. I think most of us can very deeply and personally relate to your talk and the problems you address there. I will now open the stage for discussion. If somebody wants to make a comment or a question, you can raise your hand. Gianfranco?
Yeah, hi, Laura. Thank you very much for your presentation. It is, as Marta said, extremely interesting, and I am really and very doubtful if I will suggest to some of my scholars in secondary school if really it's a good idea to begin an academic path, an academic work, or my commentary, or first of all, my commentaries, because I have some for you, concerns the notion of Derrida's unconditionality. No, that is Derrida, maybe, is one of the authors who in recent times explored this difficulty of academic humanities to reach the aim of this intrinsically unconditionality that is one of the aim of philosophical and humanities purposes. So I'm really concerning what you said at the end of your presentation, you know, I really don't understand if there's a separation between academic institution, both on the side of the state university and on the side of the markets institution. I could really reach this form of unconditionality that Derrida makes as the core point of the humanities and of philosophy in themselves. In other words, I really have difficulty to imagine one of us to have that academic or universitarian freedom that other authors, also among them who we study as Foucault, as Adot, really could have. So really, it is this concept of unconditionality that I could propose you, and it would be very interesting for me if you could comment and, well, let us better understand, if it is possible. Thank you.
My comment will be very lackluster, I think, because I've actually never read Derrida. I'm not a Derrida scholar. That is just something that, for whatever reason, I've actually never studied. So I love your comment because it gives me something else that I will have to look at and learn more. But I can't particularly, maybe someone else could better answer your question who's more familiar with that line of work. But I'm so sorry that that's just a gap in my philosophical knowledge that I can't respond to.
I can just say he has an article coming out on the topic, so we could promote Gianfranco here as someone who's thinking about this, certainly.
When's your article coming out?
It's coming out in Eidos. It's a thematic issue of Eidos, yeah?
Oh.
I presented about it, yes, but it was a possibility to approach precisely from the point of view of Laura that was not precisely in mine, what this idea of unconditionality that is for me very, very important could mean, you know, also for us, also, yes, just not in a Derrida's perspective.
Maybe I can just say as a bridge, Laura, this is sort of the Kant to Heidegger.
It is a possibility for future, too.
To Derrida connection, and it's sort of the Kant question about what does it mean to have this sort of critical lower faculty that's really independent, right? Given the conditions we know of, you know, how shaped institutions are by academic capitalism, by the culture we're in, by this late moment. So it's sort of maybe the way I'm trying to make a bridge for sort of question for you is like, how are you navigating the question of what it means to like do philosophy intrinsically as we would like to be doing it, given the sort of these enormously pervasive conditions? Oh, you see, we have another question from Sam's dog here. But
yeah, I think that's a really good question. And I don't know, like one of the things I really struggle with is I think that there probably is a distinction between academic professional philosophy and philosophy. And the struggle is how do we actually try to be philosophers while in order to do that, we have to be professional philosophers or academic philosophers. And this is, I think, maybe for us, Eli, what really started this project is there's this sense that being a professional philosopher is consistently making us into hypocrites, because it seems to be in so much conflict with the thing that we actually want to do, but we have to do this in order to do the thing that we want to do, which is the irony of the situation. And that's the very thing that I'm trying, or we all, or Eli and I, trying to navigate is what do we actually do? How do we navigate this? And I don't want to be a fatalist and just say, okay, well, we can never actually do philosophy as it's intrinsically meant to be done within an institution. That's just really depressing, right? Are there certain kind, and I don't even know what it actually means to do philosophy as it's intrinsically meant to be done, because I've only ever done it in an institution. So I think there's this question of figuring out, is there something intrinsic to the spirit or essence of philosophy that is necessarily at odds with professionalism? Or is there a way we can navigate our world within these institutions without degrading ourselves morally as philosophers?
I see that Lukas also has also raised his hand, but I wanted to make a comment on what you just said. At the very end of your presentation, you asked how universities contributed to maintaining or warding off this kind of vices, and the whole of your presentation was around this topic. But in this, as in any other case, a vice is always the responsibility of the individual, right? Can we really make universities completely responsible for our lack of a, let's say, philosophical life, if you want? And this brings me to your comment just now, this incompatibility between academic professional philosophy and philosophy. Well, in principle, philosophy is not connected to any kind of professional activity, is always done beyond, is not identifiable with a profession, let's say. So in principle, you could be a philosopher in the terms that Ado describes. You could practice philosophy as a way of life independently of the profession you had, right? You could, you can work at a university, you can work at a post office, you can work in a supermarket, in a bar, and you can still be a philosopher. Do you think that working at the university brings us further away from this aim? Is it better for us to work at the shop, I don't know, at a post office than at a university? Or is it our responsibility that we just let ourselves be contagiated? Do you say like this, like contaminated by the atmosphere of the universities? Do we really need to be hypocrites working at the university? Can't we just do what we are paid to do? We can give our lectures, we can write our articles, and still let ourselves be transformed by what we are reading in the process, what we are teaching in the process. Do you understand my question? I mean, in a way, it seems that the profession that would be closer to our aim, if our aim is to become a philosopher, we have a profession, if we are a professor of philosophy, in principle, we have more time to read and engage with philosophical thought than if we work at the supermarket. So in principle, this would help us to become philosophers and not bring us further away from that aim. I'm not saying that being a professional philosopher or working as a professor of philosopher is being a philosopher, but it would probably help us better than any good job to do that. Or do you think it's the other way around and actually you would be more honest working, I don't know, at the garden?
I mean, I know people who are philosophers who are not professional philosophers, and they seem a lot happier than the rest of the people I know who work within academic philosophy. I do think that it's easier to study and try. I think in some ways it's easier if we are attached to a university, because to study philosophy does demand a lot of leisure time. I mean, this was the original distinction, right, between the humanities and the more technical or mechanical arts, was that those who were considered human or full citizens were those who could study the humanities, and they could only do that because they had servants and enslaved people who were doing everything else for them. It's really, really hard for people who are working all of the time, barely making ends meet, to have the time to actually study this and internalize philosophical concepts in order to live a more virtuous life. I think that they should, and I wish that we had an environment in which more people could do that outside of the university. And I think this gets to your first question, isn't it a matter of individual responsibility? Well, yes, in large part, right? Ethical choices, whether they're virtues or vices, any kind of comportment, I think it is individual responsibility in part, But I want to go back to something that Eli and Leonard Watts presented, I think, last May for the seminar. Was it in May, Eli? I'm not really sure. It was the paper on Dewey and PWL and the environment, right? And I think one of the things that we need to look at more when we're talking about virtues or vices or way of life is how deeply our environment shapes the kinds of choices that we can make and the kinds of people that can be. We are socially embedded creatures. We do exist in a context. We do exist in an environment. So for example, I'm a big advocate for the notion of Bildung in teaching, right? This is what I do. I study philosophy of education, and I always want teaching to be transformative. And I can say that's my individual choice, is to do whatever I can in the classroom to bring this into a fruition. So in terms of teaching, I am not a hypocrite. But also at the end of the day, administration is always coming down on us for enrollment, right? They're always looking at student evaluations, which takes away a lot of the stuff I would want to do in the classroom because I have to worry about evals right now. I think grading is a terrible idea. I think that evaluating students based on grades and trying to motivate them externally with something like a percentage takes away a lot from the transformative elements of philosophy, but I have to do that in the classroom. So I don't want to say that my hypocrisy in the classroom is just a matter of my individual choice when so much of what I can do is limited by institutional policies that are in some ways forcing me to be this kind of hypocrite when it comes to education if I want to remain employed, which I do.
I mean, there's a life beyond the classroom, you know. You, Laura, as a human being, as you are you a better human being because you have studied philosophy, because you have such a job, or are you an hypocrite, because you are a professional philosopher? That was more like.
I think that philosophy has made me a better person, but I also recognize that yes, there is a life outside of the classroom. But it's really hard to deal with the fact that when we're teaching things that made us better people or researching things that we believe in that made us better people, we're doing this in a context where we kind of have to do things that we don't agree with, morally speaking.
Yeah. Okay, Lucas.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you, Laura, for your wonderful presentation. As I think I have already said before in emails that I think this project that you and Eli are doing is very important, and I consider one of the most important applications, so to speak, of this research on PWL. Some of the comments I would have. First, regarding university, and I think this is also connected to Marta's question about whether universities collaborate or not for us to lead a philosophical way of life, for us to be philosophers. I think there's no ready answer, no ready answer for that, because first of all, there are a lot of different universities across historical moments. The university is a historical phenomenon, and I think we have to have this in mind, like what kind of university are we talking about? Because it's a very different thing to talk about a contemporary university, which follows this productive logic of neoliberal capitalism and so on, and speak of the University of Nalanda, for instance, in India, or to speak of Islamic universities, or you know, there are different models and there are different ways of practicing this sort of academic education, and we don't have to take for granted that to be in the university just means to be what it means to be in university today, so to speak. So I think this would be an interesting point to further develop in this kind of study, like what other models of university do we have available, and we see also in the history of universities as such. We don't have to take for granted that the model we have today is the only possible model. And I think this model, this leads me to another comment. There's also something to be explored in Humboldt's conception of university, because I think this also has a lot of consequences to the way we do research today and the way we think about research, the connection between researching and teaching today. And it did a lot of harm, I would say, because there's this conception, there's this understanding in Hubbard's understanding of university that the university is made for research, and research is something mainly individual that the individual has to do on his own, because it's about developing your creativity as an individual and bringing about new ideas. So this collective dimension that we feel that is lacking, and ultimately the lack of this collectiveness leads to competition. I also believe it's somehow tied to how this Humboldtian model of university kind of spread throughout the globe, so to speak. But more connected to the discussion between PWL, how we could, you know, bring PWL insights into changing the way we do professional philosophy, so to speak. I really think it would be very important for us to think how we could change the structure of the institutions and the structure of education we have there, if we address not only moral questions and ethical questions per se, in the sense of, you know, what vices and virtues can we find there, but rather what is our understanding of knowledge, how our very understanding of what it means to have knowledge was transformed, and how this has consequences for the way we think that knowledge should be produced. And the very fact that I use the word produced has several consequences in that sense, because the mere fact that we think that knowledge is something that should be produced has already some consequences. And I know this might sound very abstract, but I have in mind very concrete things that Hadot says about the spiritual exercise as such. For instance, that for the Platonic tradition, in order for you to reach metaphysical knowledge, actual knowledge about the reality of things, you have to, you know, practice moral virtues, because it's about changing who you are, and at the same time, that is not separated from gaining speculative insights, because knowledge is not something that is, you know, just conceptual content precisely. And then you, one thing is knowledge has conceptual content, the other thing is our ethical qualities as such. Those things are inseparable, and it goes both ways. Training ethically changes the sort of insight you are capable of having, but the sort of insight you have also changes who you ethically are. So you have to think differently about what does it mean to have knowledge? What does it mean to have knowledge? And just to give one example that I think connects to your discussion, because about saying the truth and saying the truth in opposition to bullshitness, I think one thing that Hadot brings to us that would be interesting to think in this connection is the difference between saying the truth and being truthful. I think those are two different things, and the most relevant one in the context of a PWL perspective would be to be being truthful, because there's no guarantee that you are saying something that is true in terms of conceptual content, in terms of propositional truth. We can always be wrong about that. And this is also how Hadot reads Socrates. He's saying, look, Socrates, he does not believe that he's reaching absolute truth in what he's saying, but he's conducting dialogue in a certain ethical way that attempts to bring consent. Based on the principles we draw, we try to be consequential with what we are saying, and then reach some common presuppositions about the topic we are discussing. But this doesn't mean propositional truth. It's much more about being truthful, about being true to your discourse. And I think this is more interesting than thinking that being truthful is about saying things that are propositionally true, because this sort of thinking also leads to this productive idea of knowledge that we have to try to produce propositions that are true and so on. And then, you know, it's a slippery slope, I would say. And one last comment would be, I think it was really interesting the way you framed, you know, those vices in terms of metrics mania and bullshit. But I would also like to ask, one concern that I have is that what if building this taxonomy becomes sort of a metric on its own, you know, like you start to measure, okay, so this university has this level of bullshitness and this level of a metrics mania, and then we should do something about it. It's a question of whether we are already so rooted in this way of doing research that in a way we're still being hostage to it. But those would be some of the comments I would have. I think it was a great presentation, and it's a very important work you are doing. I would just like to add those points to the discussion.
Thank you so much for those comments. Those are really, really helpful. Though I wouldn't be so hard on Humboldt. I mean, he also really stressed the value of social bonds, right? It wasn't just individual freedom. It was freedom and social bonds. I really like this point you're making about rethinking what we mean by knowledge and tying that to truth versus being truthful. And I'm also thinking about Bill Reading's book that I cannot remember the title of it, where he discusses like how university excellence is essentially meaningless. And one of the things that we are doing in this neoliberal university when we're talking about excellence is we're actually restructuring, thank you, Eli, the university in ruins. We're restructuring the ways that different departments work. And that is both based on our idea of what knowledge means, and it works to further change our idea of what we consider to be knowledge that comes out of a university. So like instead of philosophy as this pursuit or look at some kind of investigation into culture, departments are becoming more interdisciplinary. So it gives us a completely different look at what the knowledge of philosophy is. So I think that's a really, it's a really interesting point that you're making here about knowledge and what we actually mean by it and how we can tie that to the very structure of the university itself is where I would want to go with that. Yeah, thank you.
Just one small comment. I agree with you that there is more in Humboldt as there is more in Foucault. You know, for me, it's a very similar discussion, but there's some focus on the individual that somehow I think is also connected to all this neoliberal discourse about self-realization of the individual. And somehow it's not Humboldt himself, but this is how it got, you know, directed today, I would say. But thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have two final interventions, Eli first and then Pedro Dotto. I ask you to be short because we are running out of time. Eli, we are not listening to you. Cannot hear you.
Thank you. This will be short. It's more just a follow-up for us to think about based off your discussion with Laura. I think actually the PWL tradition does not agree on this question. And that's, you know, an important example of why it's an important question. Why are the cynics and skeptics so critical of what's happening at the Lyceum, what's happening in the Epicurean Gardens, and what's happening at the Academy? They claim you're not living the values of the philosophical life intrinsically. And to do that, you know, in the cynic case, you got to be out in the agora causing problems, right? Their answer to you would be, no, that's not really a good enough to just live it on your own as some sort of individual internal process. Maybe a skeptic would. Aristotle is very clear that for to better yourself on the philosophical path, I don't think there's a disagreement here. He literally says, what do you need? Philosophical friends that uplift you asymmetrically to develop that process. What does Epicurean Garden under Philodemus ask you to do? It says, parhesia, the kind of truth-telling we need cannot be done as a separate endeavor, but with an environment that provides you the affordability to do self-criticism. I'm not saying you can't have the opinion, but I actually think just for future discussion, one interesting theme is where PWL figures fall on this. Schopenhauer, pretty critical that this can happen at universities. Nietzsche has interesting ambivalences about just where and where this can happen in higher learning. One thing I would encourage us is I think the PWL tradition has a lot of interesting, differing, contentious arguments about what sort of institutions can or cannot promote authentic philosophical life. And, you know, even the Stoics, yes, they say, well, of course, you can amor thati, you can accept whatever your conditions are, but they still have the Stoa. They still think the Stoa is worth having. They still think that helps produce authentic philosophical activity. So I think it's, I just want to encourage, because I think there's cool stuff in PWL here to really think about a very difficult question. And we don't have to answer it here, but just for the future.
It's just that you can't really compare, or you can't give the cynics as an example of what you should do now, right? Everybody needs to. I mean, because then you would live like a cynic. You wouldn't today. I mean, in the sense that everybody needs a salary, right? If you have a professional occupation, the question is just if university is really worse than any other occupation.
I don't want to take up time so we can follow up later, but I disagree with you here. I think there are actually really interesting models of, you know, cynic performative interventions. You know, you could look at things like Banksy and other performance art. I think there's a lot of models you might consider that echo Stoic tradition if you get a little creative with it. So I'm not convinced about that at all. I think there are many. I can also go to other.
I'm not convinced either. I don't really have a thesis here. I'm just questioning.
And again, all I could encourage here, because I thought the PWL connection would be important, is I actually think there's a lot of debate amongst philosophy as a way of life traditions about where you authentically do this. The humanists, you know, Erasmus and Petrarch have very different views about just how authentic this can happen in medieval universities. So I think there's just cool things to think about anyways.
You know, Pedro?
Yes. Thank you very much, Laura, for this presentation. It's a very necessary criticism, just like harsh criticism, but honest. And it's also particularly depressing for young scholars like myself who recently defended the PhD. But it's an accurate picture of what I take to be the state of affairs in our world. So thank you for bringing this into discussion. It actually reminded me, like, this discussion we are having and the follow-up of your presentation, of that famous sentence by Adorno that there is no right life in a wrong world. And you could paraphrase that in a sense that there is no philosophical way of life in the neoliberal academia, the neoliberal university for 21st century. But in any case, we can try, and there is space for resistance. I don't want to be that fatalist, as I know from your presentation that you also are against such fatalism, that there is nothing condemned, it's all corrupted by this neoliberal logic. And I don't have any particular question to make. I just want to know, how can I follow up on your project, or how can I follow the development of this project, and maybe for discussing it with you, because it was very interesting what is coming up, and I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, thank you for that question about following up. You can just email me. I think, are email addresses listed on the mapping
website?
Yeah. You can just send me an email or send Eli an email, because the thing is, we don't have any plans to do anything with this right now. It is a fun project for us, I think. And this kind of, it brings me back to something Lucas said, which is like, well, how can you make sure that you're not falling prey to the very thing you're writing about as you're writing about it? And I think one of our ways of doing that is we have no plans to do anything professionally with this, aside from this right now. But Pedro, you should definitely get my email address from the website and just send me an email and we can talk more. Yeah.
Maybe you can fund that project through academy, through an university funding agency. That would be ironically funny.
Maybe. I'm enjoying the refreshing ability to write about something and not really professionally care what happens in terms of publication.
Okay, thank you so much. It's now time to close the session. Thank you again, Laura, for this brilliant presentation. And thanks all of you for being there and for participating in the discussions. We will come back on February 14 with a talk by Daniel Wisch. And yeah, hope to see you then.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.